Hi, I am Dr. Sridhar Kalyanasundaram, consultant neonatologist. Welcome to my channel. Thank you for watching the ventilation series. Thank you for sharing it with your colleagues. I hope you have turned your notifications on as well. So following on in the series, we will be reviewing non-invasive ventilation in a brief way. So respiratory support without the use of endotracheal intubation is non-invasive ventilation. The main benefits, it's obviously cheaper than invasive ventilation. The machine itself is cheaper. Of course, nowadays most of the ventilators come with the ability to use all aspects of non-invasive, right from NAPPV, CPAP and high flow. That makes it easier if you want to have fewer equipment. However, because of the lower cost and more babies needing non-invasive ventilation, you can have standalone machines as well and use the ventilators mainly to wean them off from extubation, for example, for a day or two. NAPPV, of course, needs a ventilator. We have less airway and lung injury and potentially less bronchopulmonary dysplasia. There is less infection because you are not overcoming the baby's own ciliary mechanism in the airway. Facilitates successful extubation and improved parental interaction, especially with the high flow and with NAPPV when we use a cannula like a RAM cannula, for example. So how does NAV work? We recruit the lung volume, we maintain the functional residual capacity and improves oxygenation, stabilizes the upper airway, stabilizes the chest wall. So all these are similar mechanisms where the pressure helps in keeping the lung open. It avoids the high compliance chest wall closing down, and this reduces the work of breathing. And by not allowing the lung to close down and shear stress reducing, we help to conserve the baby's own surfactant. The surfactant recycling works better in this setting. One of the points I would like to make here when you are using it practically is that this recruiting lung volume is very important. We might have a baby on, say, a weaning pressure on CPAP or high flow. The baby has a few episodes of apnea, either due to a mild reflex episode or because of mild aspiration episode, which may happen. Baby is not otherwise sick, it's just this temporary blip. So you can re-recruit the lung volume by increasing the pressure for 2-3 hours, and then the recurrent apneic episodes will reduce. So if you don't intervene early enough, the lung keeps losing volume with each apneic episode because the baby is in breathing. The lung volume comes down and the FRC reduces. Hypoxia happens in these settings, and hypoxia causes apnea further. So it's a vicious cycle. So you have to break the cycle by recruiting and opening the lung volume. Don't hesitate, increase the pressure briefly, and once the lung volume is re-recruited, you can come back down. So this is an important tip you should tell your nursing staff and empower them to do it even without discussing with you. 1 or 2 centimeter increase for half an hour, 1 hour on the CPAP, or a flow increase of 2 to 3 liters from say 3 liters to 5 or 6 liters makes a difference to the baby. And if you empower them and they're able to watch and reduce it back, it doesn't do any harm as well. So what are the risks of NAV? Air leak, if you overdo it or if you don't treat the lung condition appropriately, as in the use of timely use of surfactant. Abdominal distension and perforation thankfully are not common, and most of us practice leaving the feeding tubes open between the feeds. Intolerance to feeds because of the CPAP belly, where the gas distance and the intestinal motility is hampered. You can use hourly feeds in these babies. Continuous feeds can be considered as well to overcome this, as a lower volume of feed with every feed and allowing more time to empty. We have risk of infection, and nasal trauma is reducing as well with more use of high flow and NAV with RAM cannula or similar appliances. And we have ability of the nurses to monitor. We have the duoderm and other protective options as well. So we shouldn't take NAV lightly. If there is untreated surfactant deficiency, for example, timely surfactant replacement, early surfactant therapy where you have FAO2 more than 0.3 is very important. Where you have reduced effort, for example, in shock and sepsis, where you may need to take over the ventilation to reduce the work of breathing and to generally support the baby's condition, you may have to ventilate rather than continue, consider non-invasive ventilation. Abdominal disease, again, because of the distension with the gas, it may compromise, and so you may consider brief period of ventilation. Reduced respiratory drive, non-invasive mode will not work because the baby's effort is low. This can happen with these conditions as well. Nasal trauma, you have to think out of the box and use alternative options. If you have congenital anomalies of the lung or airway, nasal malformations, cleft palate, tracheal esophageal fistula, again, you have to improvise. Modes of non-invasive ventilation, NIPPV is coming up quite well in the extremely small preterm babies. Nasal CPAP is of course used for a very long time. Biphasic CPAP in the late 70s, Gregory et al. Introduced CPAP, and after that we have come leaps and bounds in its use. Indigenous CPAP, where units design their own CPAP, then the machine CPAPs come up. Biphasic CPAP is an adaptation of nasal CPAP, where we get a bi-level of CPAP. NIPPV as well, we discussed, it's like ventilation but non-invasive. Humidified high flow has come up quite a bit, and we will discuss partly how to use it as well. And non-invasive NAVA is available as well, where your synchronization happens by the neurally adjusted ventilatory assist mechanism. So these are different devices you can use. So the bubble CPAP, the infant flow driver, the CPAP device, you have many other devices as well. And we have different interfaces which are very important. So the binasal prongs, the mask, we have the different types of nasal prongs, different materials, the Hudson prongs, which are quite well used in Colombia, which were pioneers in establishing the role of CPAP in neonatal intensive care. So the infant flow driver works on the fluidic flip mechanism. Some of you may be familiar with this, that we have the expiratory limb which is open, and during the inspiration the flow is driven to the baby, and during expiration the fluidic flip stops the flow from the ventilator so the baby can breathe out easily, while the expiratory branch will deliver the PEEP. Bubble CPAP works on the principle of the initial indigenous CPAPs that were devised. So the fluid, the expiratory limb bends in the fluid which is immersed, and the depth of immersion adjusts, and some studies have shown that the pressure delivered is a little more than the pressure you set, but there is good flexibility. You don't need to have PEEPophobia, and as long as the baby's retractions are reduced, the oxygen requirement is stabilizing, you can monitor and titrate. So the bubbling gives a high frequency like effect according to some others, and it has a stimulation effect, so reducing apnea, improving the lung recruitment, so many units prefer bubble CPAP as well. So in terms of NIPPV, the ventilator is used, and the nasal or nasopharyngeal prongs provided with the ventilator to connect to the adapter is used. Ram cannula was an adaptation that was brought in by Professor Ramanathan, and you have his videos on the channel as well. It's quite handy, and now many ventilators are providing high flow like cannula interfaces, which makes it easier for baby handling. So the pressures are starting with the PIP and PEEP slightly above the pre-extubation levels, and you can wean them as needed, and weaning from NIPPV to CPAP and then to high flow as per the baby's condition is quite often the way we do it. You have synchronized options, which is difficult. The infant star use the Grace B capsules, which have been phased out, and NAVA to synchronize NAV is an option as well. So biphasic CPAP is not NIPPV because it provides a lower level of support. It provides a bi-level of CPAP really. So the baseline CPAP is there with an additional higher pressure of 2 to 4 centimeters above the baseline. This is flow driven, so you have a limit on how much you can do. There is no valve in the ventilator circuit, for example. And the rate and duration can be set. We keep an eye time of 0.5 or so for the NAV as well as BiPAP. It can be used with or without trigger. Here the trigger is a Grace B capsule like mechanism as well. Humidified high flow nasal cannula has many advantages for the nursing staff and for the parents as well, because it's easier to maintain. People feel safer to use it. The main disadvantage is that it may put you in a false sense of reassurance. So if there is an acute disease, you better or managed on CPAP, because you have an ability to increase the pressure more reliably in a higher fashion. Here the limitation is that we don't want to exceed a certain level of flow in newborns, for example 8 liters per minute, and the level of pressure that you can generate depends on the seal at the nose. You should have a good leak around the nose. If you have a tight seal, you may give inadvertently high pressures, and you may have noise damage to the ears as well. So we should be careful when we use high flow for acute disease. And it has been shown in studies to generate positive pressure in the airways. As I said, there is a gradual increase from 2 liters to 8 liters. You may show a PEEP of 3 to 5, for example, developing in the airway. So it depends on the size of the baby, the flow rate, and the prong size. So this is an illustration of how increase in the flow results in increase in pressure, but there's quite a big variation. The main disadvantages is that the pressure is not monitored, And in the vapor term, the neonatal cartridge delivers a water vapor, which is a fine form of humidification. And in the Fischer-Paykel device or OptiFlow, it's a similar mechanism, but we don't have the cartridge. It's a usual humidifier circuit that we use. So it's simple to set up and includes a soft nasal cannula, which are of different sizes appropriate for the baby. The main tip here is that the leak should be at least 50%, and so you don't inadvertently generate high pressures. So this is a Vapotherm and this is the OptiFlow device. Most of you are familiar with either of these. And NAVA is neurally adjusted ventilatory assist, and it delivers the assist in proportion to and in synchrony with the patient's respiratory efforts. The EDA signal from the diaphragm is picked up by the probe. It's only available in the MAC-A ventilators, and it can be used along with the suitable interface for NAPPV or NAVA. So this is the EDA catheter. You have the electrodes reading ECG light tracings on the screen, and you adjust the EDA catheter position according to the height and the color on the readings. It needs some training to adjust it and whether you want to use it for non-invasive ventilation. Many units are reporting successful outcomes, but it does come with the cost for the catheter and training costs for the staff in using it as well. So there is no significant evidence to support universal use, and some sites are comfortable and they do report good outcomes. And EDA is very variable in neonates as well, and catheter positioning can be difficult. We do have catheters which can double up as feeding tube as well. However, the cost consideration has to be, especially when a unit is already doing well with the non-synchronized modes of non-invasive ventilation. So in the next video, we will discuss the approach to choosing the mode and the type of ventilation, including in what situations we consider high flow versus NAPPV versus CPAP in the non-invasive. So both invasive and non-invasive modes, how we choose the ventilator mode. We have had an overview so far on settings on the ventilator as well as the modes and in non-invasive ventilation as well. I hope this series is useful. I request you to keep the notifications on. Do subscribe if you have not done, so that you can follow this, and do share with your colleagues, nurses, and everyone in your team. Thank you so much for watching.